Hi everyone, my name is Marilena Gutierrez. I am the director of the View Conference. I will be your host today for this interview. Today we are interviewing the splendid storyteller, the award-winning director of Bombay Rose, Gitanjali Rao. Thank you, Gitanjali, for being here with us.
Thank you, Maria Elena. It is always a pleasure. I would never say no to you. Because we had such a nice time talking already, and even the questions. I'm looking forward to this.
Thank you. We are very excited to have you. And just for our audience, I would like to mention that this interview is made possible by the View Conference. The View Conference is the biggest computer graphics conference in Italy, and it happens once a year in October. This year, our dates are from the 17th to the 22nd of October. And for details about the conference and tickets and all those sorts of things, please visit the website viewconference.it.
Dreams can be pondered over anywhere. So why the sea?
Dreams have no boundaries there.
How much? 100 rupees for 10.
Well, Salim, you know what I mean, right?
Hello, Tara. Who is this young lady with you?
It's Miss D'Souza. I wish to hear only good English in our class together.
He saved Cat from that truck and I saved him from being arrested. So he hero and I hero.
Take this for the flowers and also to stay away from the girl.
Hey, wait. Listen, wait. Salim.
Kamala.
Answer me, eh? I'm going to totally ruin you and everyone in your family too.
You know, I am really intrigued by your beautiful work. I think that all the work I have seen from you, from Printed Rainbow to your debut feature film, Bombay Rose, is really impressive. I mean, you're really a master storyteller. You know, I'm just very excited to have the opportunity to interview you. And in fact, I would like to ask my first question is about the medium of animation. Why is animation your preferred form of art?
When I passed out of college at the age of like 20, 21, all I wanted to do was to get involved in making films. And at that time, it was live action films because that is what I had seen. And I was enamored by films from India, from all over the world, whatever little one could see back in the 1990s. This is before, of course, the internet. So I finished my art college and my art college enabled me to get into advertising. But I was quite sure I didn't want to do advertising. I wanted to get into some way of making movies. And it was impossible for me to do a course in filmmaking. I had to get onto a job. And this was 1994, so things were very difficult at that time. And somebody told me that there is a course of that there is a studio which does animation, and it is interested in taking art students and teaching them animation, training them to become animators. And around this time, I had watched a short, a film festival in Bombay, where they had shown animation films by a Polish animator called Jerzy Kucza. It was a retrospective of his entire lifetime of work, and it was only seven films. And they were not very long. They were all short films. But the films were very, very beautiful. They were very evocative. They were very poetic. There was a lot of cinema in it. There was very little spoken. It was all etched in on film and drawn very beautifully. And for me, this was my first exposure to animation, which is not necessarily Disney. And at that time, there was only Disney. There was no Pixar, no DreamWorks, nothing. So it was not the conventional animation. It was very unconventional. It was very personal. It had a very strong message. And it was very socio-politically aware. So at that point, I felt this is the most beautiful way of bringing the fact that you can draw and paint and that you want to make a film out of it together. So animation for me became that medium where I could pursue my dream of getting into films. And I could also pursue what I had studied, which was art, and to make the two things come together. And so I joined the studio, and for the first 6 months, we got training, which is, of course, in the conventional style of animation. But when it comes to training, I think it's very nice to have a conventional base and a background. So we were learning the Disney kind of animation. And that kind of gave me the skill, which I even today have, today possess to be able to make my films. So somewhere this want to get into the movies and also the fact that I can draw came together in animation, and therefore animation, and it has stayed like that.
Wow. I really love your rich style, your rich language, and my follow-up question will be about your creative journey, how you discovered your personal style, your artistic vision, your voice, and because you have a very particular voice.
Again, I would like to thank you for the compliment, because I think I'm still searching for it. And if you say you feel I have a voice, then that makes me feel yes, I do. And I think that's very healthy for most artists to let it be a reflection, to let people inform you that you have a voice. I started working in an animation studio, which was doing a lot of advertising work, a lot of commercial work. So over there, we were taught animation, which the basics of animation from the formula from Disney. And that, as I said, it works very well when you need to learn your skill. But I was never really satisfied in doing that kind of animation all the time. There was also another thing which would happen is that people around the world would be doing beautiful animation. And when it came to India, this is again back in the 90s, we were very young. So we were asked to do animation like it is done in the rest of the world. So the studio that I came from was always attempting to do animation, which is not really Indian, which is not our voice, but which sells or which is popular. So we were trained to become good in that kind of animation. And the more and more I did it, the less and less attracted I felt to it, the less and less I believed in it. At that same time, there was one of the people from the studio who had gone and joined National Film Board of Canada. So she used to send us these VHS cassettes. At that time, it was videos. So she used to send us these video cassettes, which had all of National Film Board of Canada films in one VHS, three volumes. And in a little place in India, where, again, when there's no internet, you receive this video cassettes and you watch the films, and it is films from all over the world. And it's very, very individual style of animators doing short films. So for me, this became my inspiration. I felt if this is what artists are doing all over the world, then I want to do this also. Except how to do it and how to go about doing it was very different. All these countries had support from support in terms of finance and funding from the countries to be able to make short films, because short animation films are not cannot make too much money. But that situation was not there in India. When I was inspired by it, I said I want to try and make it, and I started working on trying to develop my own style. Of course, it was very, very difficult. I remember doing a workshop with Jerzy Kucia, the Polish animator whose films I had seen and decided to take animation. 3 years later, he was back at the same festival and he was doing a workshop. And there was just 10 of us, and it was just a 3-day workshop, but it was very precious because here there was somebody from Poland whose work you really like coming and sharing his experience with you. So I joined the workshop, and we had a very nice, intense session where he told me about my films, that I do not have a style of my own and that I should pursue it. And so since I was self-taught in animation, I used to take these opportunities. The next year, I went to Poland and I did a 1 month long workshop in Poland with Jerzy Kucha. And there, that's where I realized how the students over there are encouraged to follow their own style. I came back and started working in a way that took advantage of the fact that I could take a lot of, I could imitate a lot of different styles. So finally, my style became telling a story in which I bring to life an imagery or a form of art and learn how to animate it, explore how to animate it and animate it in my films. So finally, I took a lot of styles which didn't belong to animators, which belong to miniature paintings, still art, chalk paintings, the arts that I was seeing around me in India. And I started moving them, animating them and exploring how to animate them. And they all came into my films.
One of the things I really love about Bombay Rose is, the way you use different artistic styles, different visual styles. But I mean, you're telling, I mean, the movie is really is utterly complex. I mean, it's happening at the storytelling level, the music level, the dance level. And I think you use language which is symbolic. I mean, you're using very effectively folklore and legend and the language of mythology and fables. And I think this is like very unique. I mean, to me, the way you fragment the linear narrative, using this symbolic language, which gives a sense of plurality. And obviously it's the space of legend, it's the space of storytelling. I mean, when you go in the head of your characters, I mean, it's really interesting. I mean, there was a question that I was going to ask you about. Really, the linear narrative happening in the story and how you are using that as a way of fragmenting time and space through mythology and fable and the space of dreams, the stream of consciousness kind of approach. And I think that is really interesting. I mean, I had to see the movie a few times just to understand how you were opening up the space. And you, maybe there's a sequence in which we're watching the textures and rich colors of the market. And then suddenly we are in a palace and you are in a space of mythology.
The way you read it is beautiful, because one makes so much of an effort, but people don't get it. So when you elaborate on it, of course, it feels very nice, because this is the reason why we put everything that we do into every film. How I look at it is, for me, the characters, each of the characters and all my characters in all my films are dreamers. I feel all people are dreamers. All of us have a capacity to dream, to imagine, to fantasize. This happens all the time. Like whenever we are in a difficult situation, or like when we are very uncomfortable, we are in a flight and it's really long and you're losing patience. You start imagining yourself in a better place, in a better time. I do that a lot. And I feel people escape from the mundane reality of life and they daydream. All of us, if given a chance, love to daydream. And daydreaming is very relaxing. It just brings your life stress, everything down to normal. It's like doing yoga or having a drink or any of these things. It's very precious and we don't seem to have time for it at all. We don't pay much respect to it, but I am a daydreamer and I see people around me doing that. And for me, all my characters have time in life to do that. The reason being, they have very complex lives. And if I have to tell their life stories, I would also like to tell what they do in their leisure or what they do in order to cope with difficult times. So the girl, when she's weaving her garland, it's a very mechanical job. She has to do so many of them through the day for 3 or 4 hours and sit in one place. She has a lot of time to think. And she thinks and she dreams and she wishes that she was out of this place and that things were beautiful, that a prince would fall in love with her and take her on a horseback and all those kind of dreams. So she dreams freely. Now, I would love to go into her dream and through the dream, not just show her wasting time, but show what she's all about, the history that she comes from. So I take the two things and I make it a richer story by allowing my characters to go into their dream spaces. Their dream spaces are not necessarily just imagined spaces. They can be legends that have happened in the place that they come from, which happens to the young girl. She comes from a place in Mandu, in India, where there is a story about a Muslim prince falling in love with a Hindu girl because she could sing very well. And finally, she had to jump down from the fort because the army attacked them. So that was a tragic story. But there is a real Romeo and Juliet legend that happened. And this girl is thinking about that. So all my stories are very, very rooted in reality. Yet, I take them into the level of fantasy purely by the way I visualize it. So for the boy, he has seen these paintings on his truck. And of course, when he's doing these paintings on the truck with his father, like any person would, you see those images coming into life and taking you away from the mundaneness. Same with the old woman who has acted in films. For her, she wants to relive that period of her life, which was very pleasant, even in the cruel reality of today. So what does she do? She imagines she's still living in that time. And it's not very difficult to live in that time, to put your own music, to close yourself, to have your little cat, and to keep yourself in a space where everything seems to be at that time. But it also extends when she goes out of her house. Now, that's the beauty of animation. We can actually, because of the medium of animation, some things which are impossible to do in live action, I can do it quite easily in animation. And I love doing things which are impossible to do in live action. So when the old woman walks out into a Bombay of 2017 or 18, as she walks, the Bombay turns into 1950s and how it used to be at that time. So that is also a reality. That's not something that she imagines. That is a reality of Bombay 1950s. So I get a chance to read through her to let the audience relive that fantasy. So yes, to make my stories rich, I use their imagination and also to make my characters richer, to show where they came from, what they have lost and what they are working towards.
I loved the way you used time to tell the story of Miss Souza. I mean, yeah. She lives really frozen and crystallized in time in her memories. And it's interesting how, I mean, older people tend to have that kind of vision. They live in the past more than living in the future. But Tara is more looking to the future, talking about, or the present, her scores, and she's more in the present time. So it's interesting how you also give the richness of the characters and the generational diversity between the characters through how they perceive time and space. I thought it was just beautiful how you were like in theater, like you're changing the backdrop, you're changing the scene. And as she's walking along, she's the color is changing. And when she has that whole monologue in front of the mirror and she's 30 years younger or so, and she's in black and white and she's in color, just like splitting the character like that, is thought it was just really, really a masterful gesture.
This is the reddest rose. The bestest smell.
Best.
Best smell.
I think you have answered this question already to a certain extent, the question about your mentors. I'm curious, you know, but maybe you can go deeper. I mean, telling us who are some of your animation heroes. You mentioned one already, your storytelling heroes, you know, people who have influenced your life, whether they were other animators or maybe non-artists. I mean, who are the people who have inspired you and who have been influential in your life?
Especially for someone like me, who's not studied formally, who's not formally studied cinema, not formally studied animation, I have studied from mentors, from individuals, and not just in animation. In animation, of course, my biggest mentor has been the Polish animator Yajikuchio from about 25 years back that I first met him and then continued doing my work. So even as I made Printed Rainbow, I showed him my storyboard. And even when I was making True Love Story, of course, it was over the internet because going to Poland was not easy. But he was always there for me until I was making short films. Another person who under whom I learned animation and who I worked with was Ram Mohan. He's a father of Indian animation. Just about all of us, my generation and later, have studied animation under him. So we all come from a place where, from a place and a time where there were not too many animation institutes in India teaching. There was probably one or two, and there would be 10 seats or 15 seats, and we are like a million people. So it was very insufficient. So for us, Ram Mohan became like an unofficial school of teaching a lot of us, for about three generations of animators that exist right now have learned under him. So Ram Mohan has been my biggest mentor, 2 years that I worked with him. And while I was working with him, one of his students, Ajit Rao, went to the US on a scholarship and just for 3 months. And when he came back to Sheridan School, so when he came back with this syllabus of how Sheridan teaches animation. And then he called a bunch of us, and he, over 6 months, he taught us animation as it was taught over there. This was very precious for people like us. Again, you're so cut off from the rest of the world. We're a third world country. There's no internet. There's no way we can go abroad and study. So this person goes and he comes back, and 20, 30 of us learn the basics of animation. So Ajit Rao is one person who not just taught me animation, who also taught me to value Indian art. He introduced me to the folk art of India, the miniature paintings, which I follow so much, shadow puppets, which I follow so much. I used to sit in his house and go through his library, which had all these books, and sit and learn. So it was like that, friends, mentors. Apart from this, I also did theater for 3 years. And that was, again, a very influential part because I use it a lot in animation, my what I learned in theater. So as you say, my shots look theatrical. Yes, that has, again, been my inspiration a lot. I love the form of the theater. I would want to do a lot more, but once I got into animation, I couldn't. So Satyadev Dubey, he's not alive anymore, but he has taught me animation. And again, like Ajit Rao, like Ram Mohan, he has taught a bunch of us, an entire generation who was in Bombay, who has learned theater and acting in theater through this person. And all this was at that time in the 90s, people were not charging for it. It was not a business. It was done as something that they like. So you worked, you earned your bread, you've made money. And then in your spare time, you did all these things. So I think these four people have shaped all the work that I do today. And in my formative years, what I learned. So even today, when I need to fall back to animation or fall back to acting, these are my mentors.
I'm going to take one of the questions, which is towards the end, but it was the one about how animation, acting and animation go hand in hand. And I wonder if you could speak to that.
Yeah, when you see Bombay Rose, it's very different from all other animation books because I have never recorded my voice actors acting. What is usually done in animation films is you have a voice actor and you shoot the actor doing the acting, or you even motion capture them, and that is translated onto the characters. I never wanted to do that kind of, I didn't want to take that way of doing it because I felt you are just taking an actor and who is doing everything for you, and you're doing it in animation. So for me, the creativity is not huge. Of course, it is debatable, but for me, it is not. For me, I feel every animator should act and feel like the character himself or herself and then bring it out. It's a very, very difficult process. Even my animators hated me because I said, I'm not going to make it easy for you, and I'm not going to shoot somebody who's perfect and does very good acting and you just copy it. It's not going to be so easy. You have to feel the emotion. You have to act it. And of course, animators are very shy people. They don't know how to act or anything. And for me, it was like, okay, doesn't matter. I will act out some of the characters for you. Just watch me. You're not shooting me. You're not taking a reference. Watch me. Feel it and then bring it out. It was very, very difficult. But when they did it, they started enjoying it so much because after that, they realized, they said, we can never go back to the earlier form of animation. So for me, some of the characters, I did a lot of casting in the characters. Some of my animators were very good with certain characters because they were as a personality similar to that character. So they could feel the personality, they could act well, and then I would help them. I would also help them with hand-holding them in terms of drawing. But each of them had to feel the emotion, had to act. And I said, you don't have to act in front of me. Do it in your mind. Do it when you just wake up. Do it in a bathroom. Doesn't matter, but it has to come down into your drawing. And slowly, slowly, they start watching actors. They start looking at acting. They start understanding what acting is all about when they have to bring it down to their drawings. And I would also do it for them. So this, in a way for me, acting, because I've done it in theater, I realized that the same role can be played by three different people. Each person puts in something very different in that character. When you do it in theater, you have understudies. One show, one person is performing. Another show, someone else is performing. The play works, the character works, but there is this little touch which is so different between the actors. And that never happens in films. It is locked. So I use that theatrical thing in animation. Each time, let the animator feel it, bring it out, and that will be the truth.
Nadia nano mein rahe rang sunaye beeti kahani gandh kabhi na hove purani ungli pakad kar hum khushboo ke beete kal mein chale.
I have a question about the music. The music of the movie is really beautiful. Again, it adds another layer of complexity. I mean, even though I didn't understand the language in the traditional in Indian music, I found it very beautiful and very powerful. So, I'm wondering what inspired your musical choices and how did you choose your sound designer? I mean, can you talk a little bit about the music in the movie?
Yeah, my sound designer, PM Satish, is somebody I've worked with for the last three or four films that I've made. And we have such a beautiful sync. And I feel in my film, I absolutely control the visual part of the film. But the only person I creatively actually collaborate with is my sound designer. Because the rest of it, I have a very clear picture of what I see. But I leave it on him as to what I hear. And we sing so well and he's so good. And he's a very celebrated sound designer. But just because he's my friend, he works on all my films. And he also finds it a beautiful canvas because I'm the only person who gives him a film with no sound at all, and he has to start from silence. Whereas all other live action films that he does comes with scratch sound and then you're changing it. So he finds it a playground where he can start from zero. And most of the time, I don't interact with him too much at a basic level at all. At a very creative level, we sit together and we decide how the film should sound. My music choices are it's a very different story from sound design. Now, in animation, one of the first things that you need to do is to make an animatic of the entire film. And animatic is something I make by myself individually. It takes me a year to make an animatic for a feature film. It took me 1 year for Bombay Rose. But I do it myself because that's really the part where you actually start and finish the film. And the rest is just animation. So it's got all the creative calls, everything. And the animatic is edited to about 90, 95 minutes that the film is going to be. When I'm making those images and when I'm editing them, and this happens over a year. So you need to sustain the rhythm of the film, and music helps a lot. So whenever I'm editing, I use a lot of music. And this is before I have started making the film. So when I do my visuals, I tend to use or choose music which exists and something which I've grown up hearing, something which I love. And in Bombay Rose, the design essentially for music was all the kind of music that people listen to. My characters listen to certain music, which happens in Bombay. When you get out of your house, you enter the lift and there is a music. And then you go down and then you meet a crowd of people and somebody has music on their mobile phone. Then you get into a taxi or a rickshaw and that person is playing his music. And then you come out and then there's another elevator to reach your office. And then in the office, just before you enter, the young people are playing some music that they want to. In the evenings, they're dancing to some other music. So you're surrounded. It's a very noisy city. You're surrounded with people's choices of what music they play. And this for me is very interesting. So if you're going into a neighborhood, which is of a certain culture, you will hear their music. And in a place like Bombay, it's so mixed. So the songs in my film are from different languages, from different parts of India, from different generations listening to that music. So what I've done is a kind of a montage of different music that happened, that's happened over India, that's influenced the people that who live in Bombay. And like the dreams and like their stories, the music also belongs to them. Miss D'Souza's music belongs to where she comes from, the language that she comes from. It's difficult for you to understand, but they are from 6 or 7 different languages. They might seem all Indian. And there's also a Spanish song and in the film. And the Spanish music is also what somebody who's an English-speaking Bombayite will listen to on a gramophone. So these are music which people listen to. And how I designed it when I was doing the animatics was I used all this music from the internet and I put it into the film and I edited it. And finally it was ready. And that's when my producers came on board and the finance happened. And we started working on the film saying we'll do the music in the end. But everybody fell in love with the music which existed. And this is all archival music. So we tried to get the copyrights of all the archival music which I had used in the animatics because it gelled so perfectly with the animation. We managed to get about 80 or 90% of the music that I had placed. And only one song which the girl sings in her mind was composed specifically for the film. Again, I don't like to follow the convention of animation films, I did not want a background score, which is extremely musical and heavy, which happens in a lot of Disney, Pixar, DreamWorks films. I found that noisy for my film. And I felt what is nice for Bombay is the kind of music that happens in the texture of Bombay. So background music went out and constructed music came in. It was not an easy decision. My sound designer also said, you know, I hope the producers agree to it because you have a lot of silence in the film. There are these very dramatic scenes in the film where you only hear the voice of the girl, how she would be singing, and it becomes very emotional. And nobody was convinced that it's going to work. Finally, it worked. And I was like, I really pushed for it. I found one of the most amazing singers whose voice I had heard in another film. And I got her to sing for the film. And I tortured her to create that really painful, soulful music that she creates. I didn't let her sleep the whole night before the recording. And it was quite painful. It was cathartic. But I think it worked very well for the film. I mean, she was happy with it. So music was quite, for the first time, I was trying something like this. And I think it worked because as I was telling Aram, A.R. Rahman, who's a famous Indian composer, watched it, heard it, and he said, I think your decisions of not using a background score and doing this kind of very soulful music was very good. So I felt, oh, great, it worked.
I found it very beautiful too. And I mean, even though I didn't understand the words, I had it playing in my head. You're like, you couldn't escape it. It was like, you found yourself thinking about it. It had permeated, you know, deep into my soul. And it was really interesting. And it was, I think also through the music, you give the sense of the plurality of Indian culture. Like, there's many religions, many, it's a very, very rich ancient culture. So I think you deliver that message also through a very masterful way of using music and obviously enhancing the sense of theatricality, the delivery, the punch. And of course, I love the Cucurru Cucu Paloma moment when you're drawing a parallel between Salim and Miss D'Souza. And I just I had to cry.
I'm telling you that music makes you cry because I have seen that scene without the music and it did. And the fact that the music comes in, my producer, my financier cried, and my producer said, okay, I think it's fine because I think his money is not wasted. That music and that scene, I could not see the two separate. The fact that they come together, and even in Venice, the Giona Nazzaro, the program director of Venice, who was sitting next to me, cried at that moment. And I said, oh, you found it emotional. I said, three times I've seen the film. This song and this scene makes me cry. I have cried every time I heard that song in Pedro Almodovar's movie. I have cried when I see it in Happy Together by Wong Kar Wai. That song is so evocative, and no wonder directors have used it. It has something very emotional. So it had to be there, and my producers worked really hard to get the copyrights of that song. And when someone like you, who is outside of India, tells me it affects her, I think all that effort is worth it. As you said, it takes it to an international level, and yet it is a very believable Indian. It could be very well played in any English-speaking Indian house, even today.
After that moment of the climax, when you see Kamala throwing the trinkets in the garlands in the water, it's like a cathartic moment. It's like a moment of rebirth, you know? And then she walks into the frame.
No, I think all cultures are very universal when it comes to the emotions. The sea, the casting, the flowers, sea, music, it's so universal because the emotions that they create are absolutely universal. So for me, because my films traverse on a path of emotion, I feel they're very comfortably universal. I don't have to make an attempt. I know everybody will cry in any part of the world when something emotional happens. It doesn't have to be specific. We are all very full of empathy, and all cultures are also very believe in empathy. So some emotion which a certain culture evokes can be felt on the opposite side of the world purely because that emotion is completely common. And grief is the main emotion. All of us feel grief, music, even if, as you said, you don't understand the words, it's the pathos, it's a tune, it's a melody, it's the feeling of the music, which does half the work. The words need not be understood. So music, I think, is so laden. It, again, has a universality, and imagery of certain things with emotions has a universality. And after a point, I wish people will forget it's an Indian film or that it's an animation film, and they will just be with the characters in the story and feel what they're going through.
You decided to make a movie in which the protagonists are people who live in the streets of Mumbai. You know, I was saying that there is a fragility about poverty. People lose their job. I mean, there is this innate fragility. Obviously, this project of having as subjects of a movie people who are the have-nots, the marginalized. It reminded me of Luis Buñuel's Los Olvidados, his movie he made in Mexico, or it reminded me of the Italian neorealist tradition, which movies like Bicycle Thief or Rome Open City or Shusha, which have as subjects people who are poor. In the Buñuel movie and in the neorealist movies, there's usually just a gloomy, tragic ending. There's no, contrary to your movie where you have closure, you have emancipation. I mean, the sense of loss gives way to a rebirth and new opportunities. I mean, do you believe there's hope for people living in the streets of Mumbai?
The difference between the rich and the poor in a place like Bombay is not too much, as opposed to, say, a first world country like Italy, where the poor are really poor and the rich are not at all. This is the beauty of a third world country, and I still believe we are one, no matter what the government would like us to think, because of the number of people below poverty line. The percentage of people below poverty line in this country is so huge. Yes, you might have 11 people who are richer than everybody else in the world, but that is not, it's the inequality. Yet, you know, in a very large sense, a space like Bombay and like Delhi is where the poor and the rich are thrown in together. We all have to live together. We all have to interact with each other all the time. And it's not very separate. So I feel very involved with them. Yes, I'm privileged in a lot of ways to be able to be educated, to be able to choose the work that I want to do, and they don't. And the fact is that, again, unlike a first world country, in a country like India, where you have a lot of young people, where you have a lot of energy, where you have a lot of people coming. Now, these are not poor people by birth. These are, a lot of them have lived in smaller cities or villages where they might have land, where they have different kinds of wealth, but it doesn't work for them. So in search of opportunities, they come to a place like Bombay. And then it's very cruel, because a lot of times they would want to go back and live that idyllic life, but then you get trapped. So you have a situation where they're not miserable. And it all depends on how they use their opportunities. And therefore, young people, optimistic people, people who have the risk-taking abilities, when they find themselves in this situation, they work a lot harder. They do a lot of, they study in the nights, they want to come out of the situation, and which is why we are the kind of country we are right now. A lot of young, enthusiastic people who don't mind working a little extra and getting out of their situations. Similarly, with parents who have sacrificed everything for this generation of kids to be able to study and come out, are doing well. So in a sense, our country has been doing well. Even these kids that you see, these young people that you see, can get jobs, and it looks very hopeful. I would say it did look to me absolutely hopeful till the lockdown and the COVID situation, the pandemic situation happened, because that's where these people suffered the maximum. The fact that they don't have permanent homes, so they all had to go back to their villages or back to the places that they came from, or they couldn't for the longest time. So there's a lot of misery that has happened to people living on the streets in the last 1 year. But before that, I would have said, which is where my story comes from, I have seen people doing well in life. I've seen people and I've read stories about people being able to come out of their situations and do something in a city like Bombay. Again, I'm not falsely optimistic, but I would look at the stories of hope and say, yes, there is. And all of us have had to fight with whatever situation that we came in to go into another one. And it is a country which is very ready to do so, because nobody's really, really rich. Everybody's struggling to have a slightly better life.
You know, when I was mentioning Los Olvidados and Italian neorealism, I think it's a way of telling stories about empathy, of, exploring empathy and emotions of a human tragedy and difficulty. And I think you do that very well through the story, through telling the story of Salim and the little boy that they take into their home, Kamala and Tara. I think it helps us really explore our own empathy and the stories of migration, immigration. People going from the countryside to the city. I mean, those are universal stories, and it's just interesting that how you tell those stories. I mean, what is interesting to me is the strength of the women, their hands on, they're resilient, they're working, you know, the it seems like the whole society is relying on their back, right? The little girl is helps a little boy, and I mean the women seem to really advance and carry the action and advance the narrative.
Trust me, it's not fictional. I have not made any effort. I'm just telling the stories of the women who live around me, and they're all like this. They are doing more than their bit, and that is taking the country forward. Of course, it's not very appreciated, but if you were to look around, they are doing so much more. They are bringing up their kids, they are cooking at home, and they're going out and working, and then looking after very patriarchal husbands who don't cook at all and do just about anything. But they're not letting that stop them from giving it everything. All the women that I meet around me, just about all of them, are working so much harder that I would find it difficult to find a typical woman who gives up. In at least my circle of friends, my circle of people who work with my friends, the service providers of that I live with, the people that I come across with, women, especially in a place like Bombay, because it is safe, much safer than the rest of India for women to be working, they are all armed and they are working and they're putting in that extra bit. And as I was saying, about 40% of the staff on Bombay Rose was women without me making an effort. The best, I just looked at people's work and hired them. I didn't even know whether they were men or women. And they turned out to be women because they are. And as I said, it is not conscious. It is happening. Things are changing. And the only thing one needs to do is aware of it. One is not making an extra effort to only have women. But for me, it feels like if the woman is as competent as a man, I would still trust in hiring a woman, because there is so much more that comes with it. Discipline, hard work, being able to retain focus, attention. I worked in a studio which has worked with three women directors. So I think that studio is also a place where the atmosphere for women who are working is friendly and nice. And you need to keep that in control. You definitely need to be a little alert with keeping things friendly and comfortable for women. The moment you give them that, they're shining.
Well, we have time for one last question. Sadly, our time has come to an end. I would like to conclude the interview by asking you if you have any advice and encouragement for young filmmakers out there, and in particular, for young girls and women who dream of becoming directors and animators.
I think the world right now and time right now, especially after the Me Too movement, is wonderful, is very lucrative. It is something which has opened up thought, opened up talk, opened up conversations about women's representations, and it's changing very fast. So right now is the best time, I think. Like I wish, instead of 28 years back, this is a time where I was starting out my career and I was that younger, because I would have felt a huge push, and it's very encouraging. Only when you look at it as in comparison from where you came from. But the young girls now and the young women now have to take it for granted and have to be very bullish and say, this is the space that we inherit, that we possess, and very rightfully own, and go forward. And then nothing else will stop you. So I really don't need to give them any advice except say, make the most of the situation and make the situation even better as you go along for the next generation. I think the women of my generation and the women before have worked for this, and it is precious in all forms. And I feel the Me Too movement especially gave it so much of a thrust, so much of a push, so much of confidence, even for people like me to come out and voice and make changes in the studios that I worked in, to ask for certain things for women, which I wouldn't have been able to do so confidently before. So it's great. And we just need to take the confidence and the take certain things for granted, that this is our space, this is our stage, this is our time, and we should make the most of it.
Well, thank you. Let's invite everyone to check out Bombay Rose on March 8th International Women's Day. It will be released on Netflix. So I know I will be seeing it again many times. And thank you for your time, Gitanjali. And thanks for being here.
Thank you very much, Maria Elena. It is such a pleasure. And yes, March 8th, I hope everybody, March 8th onwards, watch the film, enjoy it, and like Maria Elena, cry through it. That would be my, that would give me most pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.